bastante. No, pero ella ya luego le tiene salud y se ve muy bien.
Thank you. being here, everyone. We ask everyone please sit down. Everybody can find their seat. Thank you. Thank you everybody for coming. Good evening. I am Mike Topo. I'm the chairman of the Atlanta Press Club. I'm also with CNN here in Atlanta. We appreciate all of you joining us here for our 6th annual Hall of Fame dinner. As many of you know, the Atlanta Press Club is the second largest press club in the U.S., only behind the National Press Club in D.C. We offer unique opportunities for journalists, such as tonight's event. We do things for the community. We have newsmaker events. And what we want to do is bring together the city and have the conversation about what everybody's concerned about. I want to personally thank you all for coming. You're here because you care about journalism and you care about journalists. And if there's ever a time when we need journalism, it's right now. I would now like to introduce our MC for the evening. Karyn Greer is a familiar face and name to everybody in the room. She's an award-winning reporter and anchor, spent over 25 years as a broadcast journalist. She's currently an investigative reporter at CBS 46. Everyone, please, a warm welcome for Karyn Greer.
Good evening, thank you so much. And I just will add, former president of the Atlanta Press Club many, many moons ago, thanks to Ms. Maria Saporta. Where are you, Maria? There she is. She'll rope us into anything for service. We're so proud of her. It is truly an honor in seeing this event tonight and being here with so many fabulous, wonderful people. The Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame recognizes journalists whose impact on Atlanta and the country will definitely be felt forever. Now, placed in your event programs, I'd be surprised if, you know, we weren't inducting some very special students who are also here with us this evening. So we're gonna make sure that we let you know who they are. Wanna let you know about our sponsors for this evening. Georgia EMC, Hartsfield-Jackson, Atlanta International Airport, J.P. Fuqua Foundation, the Ronald Woodruff Library, and the Russell family, tonight's bronze sponsors. Let's give them a big round of applause. A special thank you to the Southern Company, George Powell, for sponsoring the VIP reception. Round of applause to them. Include the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, Emory University, and the Stuart A. Rose Manuscript Archives and Rare Book Library. And tonight's gold-level sponsors, the Home Depot and Wells Fargo. And finally, we give a special thank you to tonight's platinum-level sponsor, George Humanities. So please welcome Kelly Caudill, who is Vice President of Communications, to say a few words for us.
Good evening. I'm Kelly Caudill of Georgia Humanities, presenting sponsor of tonight's event. Georgia Humanities is proud to show our support of the Atlanta Press Club and to say thank you for the important work that our journalists do. We absolutely need you and rely on you. Our lives and our freedom depend on you. Thank you. Georgia Humanities, an affiliate of the National Endowment for the Humanities, is a statewide organization that preserves and shares the stories and cultural legacies of people and place, past, present, and future. We partner with libraries, schools, colleges and universities, museums, cultural organizations, and community building entities to provide programs like National History Day. We partner with the Smithsonian's Museum on Main Street program to bring traveling exhibitions to smaller communities around our state. We partner with the University System of Georgia and Galileo, the University of Georgia Press, and the Office of the Governor to provide the New Georgia Encyclopedia, an online authoritative resource free to journalists and other curious people everywhere. That's georgiaencyclopedia.org, by the way. The humanities explore how people understand and express the human experience and include literature, history, art, music, language, ethics, philosophy, and much more. At Georgia Humanities, we say that we are dedicated to sharing the stories that move us and make us as Georgians and as people. I think you'll agree the connection to the practice of journalism and history is obvious. In fact, we dabble in journalist circles as often as they will let us, and since 2013, we have had a recurring column called Jamil's Georgia in the Supporter Report, edited by Maria Supporta, of course. And the author of that column is the president of Georgia Humanities, Jamil Zamaldine, who is seated right here at the front table. I would also like to acknowledge and thank my other Georgia Humanities colleagues, and especially our board member, Brian Broderick, a principal at Jackson Spalding, who joins us tonight, seated up here. So I want to quickly tell you about a special partnership Georgia Humanities has with the University of Georgia Grady College of Journalism. As you are all no doubt aware, 2016 marks the centennial of the Pulitzer Prizes. In honor of this anniversary, the Pulitzer Prize Centennial Campfires Initiative, which is a joint venture with the Federation of State Humanities Councils, offered funding for projects seeking to focus on journalism and the humanities, to imagine their future, and to inspire new generations to consider the values represented by Pulitzer Prize-winning work. With some of this funding, a team from UGA's Grady College of Journalism started their own campfire by building a website called Look Forward, a digital exhibition on civil rights and the Pulitzer Prize in Georgia. The URL is lookforwardga.org, which is available to you tonight, right now, as a sneak preview. With more than 100 unique digital artifacts, the site features 15 Georgia Pulitzer-winning journalists, authors, and historians. All of their work has contributed to the cause for civil rights. Historical context on the Pulitzer Prize and the civil rights movement is also featured. Correlated links to the New Georgia Encyclopedia abound. The Grady team recorded more than 12 hours of interviews with 20 people, and these interviews will be housed at the Special Collections Library of the University of Georgia, where they will be available to support future research on civil rights in Georgia. And I should mention that many of you in this room were interviewed for this project, so I know you're interested to see the outcome. I want to acknowledge, I want to acknowledge Dr. Janice Hume and Jason Guthrie of the Grady Journalism School. If you wouldn't mind standing up, they're the ones who put this website together. The power of such a resource is evident, and we know that Georgia's stories are national stories. Dignity, freedom, equality, all find their way into the Pulitzer stories represented here. For certain, these Georgia stories are national stories, even global stories. Although Look Forward GA, the website, will not be launched formally until January 2017, feel free to explore it now. And as a reminder, you've got a bookmark that was left in your chair. We'd love to know what you think of it. Thank you for listening, and congratulations to tonight's inductees.
Nice segue, Kelly. Thank you. And tonight's inductees, we are honoring Mr. Bud McEntee, the late Eugene Patterson, and John Smith Jr., along with the Inquirer. Woodruff. Before we get started, let's recognize the many past Hall of Fame inductees who are joining us in the room this evening. Ms. Xernona Clayton is here with us. Please stand. Mr. Tom Johnson, John Pruitt, Greer, Dale Russell, and Ms. Alexis Scott. So honored to have you all here with us this evening, very special evening. Proceeds from tonight's event fund summer internships for college students studying journalism. The Atlanta Press Club pairs students with local media outlets to help them gain hands-on experience, which we know they all need. Will the 2016 summer interns in attendance please stand for us right now and be recognized? You'll find their names, where they are, where they come from, in your program. Now, I'm sure many around the world, journalists around the world, have a soft spot, a hard, just a difficult time to stomach the news that we got about 2 weeks ago. We lost great Gwen Ifill. I know many of you are thinking about her tonight as we prepare to celebrate great journalism and induct her longtime co-host, Judy Woodruff, into the Hall of Fame. So let's have a moment of silence for Gwen and for the many great journalists we lost this year. Thank you very much. We will now have dinner, and I'll be back very shortly to begin the program. Bon appetit.
The sometimes smiling and always hard-charging, uncompromising, laser-focused Bud McEntee.
As a news director, The cliche comes to mind of Lou Grant, for those old enough to remember that television program. He was old-fashioned, he was old-school, he was all about getting it done quickly and accurately, and he was a stickler for accuracy and facts. He was a very hands-on news director. We're going to try to break down this ballot for you.
Dick Williams, the moderator of the weekly Georgia Gang political debate on WACA, joined the program about the time McEntee became news director. McEntee would watch all the evening newscast at once, demanding, of course, no less of his journalists than that they meet the others on every story, every day.
He was the last of the news directors who would come out of his office shouting at something he saw on television or something he saw happening that he didn't like. You've got to look at McEntee as a guy who stuck to his knitting, kept his integrity, protected his staff, and always was in search of better stories.
And McEntee was protecting his staff through more than one unexpected change in a tumultuous industry.
The 45-year relationship between WAGA-TV, Channel 5, and CBS is over.
In 1994, WAGA's parent company dropped a bombshell on everyone at the station by dropping CBS and its global news gathering operation and replacing it with Fox. Fox, back then, had The Simpsons. There's no Fox News Channel. Not yet.
It's 6 a.m., and this is a good day in Atlanta.
McEntee saw it as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for his journalists. He took control of Channel 5's new, valuable airtime.
From 4:30 to 10 a.m. on Fox 5.
And ultimately, McEntee was able to triple his mobile newscast to nearly 60 hours a week, more than any other station in the market. And viewers stayed with WACA.
There's still a great thirst for local news.
That's McEntee speaking at an Atlanta Press Club forum in 2009, insisting that the challenge wasn't to fill the extra quantity of airtime, but to fill it with consistent quality. His pride and joy?
It's only five words. Five words that strike fear in corrupt politicians.
The nationally renowned I-Team.
Five words that make the difference between ripoffs and reform.
I'm with the I-Team.
Dedicated, determined, and dependable.
Good evening, I'm Brenda Wood.
And I'm John Marler. We begin tonight with the results of a three-month I-Team investigation.
There was a time when corporate budget cutters prior to Fox targeted the I-Team. McEntee told the story at the same press club forum in 2009, the year before he retired from WACA.
There was a recommendation that we scale down investigative reporting, and I fought hard along with a couple of other folks, and instead of scaling back, we expanded the I-Team.
McEntee never said whether corporate owners ever again tried to scale back the I-Team. His pride and joy thrives.
Their muscle is here now, and things not exactly as they seemed here.
No, Sinead, they're not.
McEntee nurtured generations of young journalists to become story-breaking veterans who stayed with McEntee and WACA most of their careers.
McEntee had been there so long, he really knew his turf. And he kept his people for long periods of time, so that institutional memory was always there.
I mean, the average lifespan for a news director is somewhere between 2 years and 2.5 years. So 20 years is way beyond beating the odds. It's sort of like living to 150 years. Just don't do it. So it says a lot to him about Bud and his quality.
Monday 11 on CBS 46 News.
Mark Pimentel is the vice president and general manager of Atlanta's CBS 46. And he and McEntee have worked with and competed against each other since their first jobs in TV news.
At his core, he is a true newsman. He understands good journalism, good storytelling. He was a great judge of talent. He hired some great people.
Fox 5 News at 6.
And Pimentel points out that to this day, you can still see Bud McEntee, the McEntee legacy, on every newscast.
He built really the foundation of what they are today in terms of news product. Whoever has come behind him has built on that. But without the foundation that Bud had laid, they wouldn't be where they are today.
Bud McEntee, inducted into the 2016 Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to our investigative report of 2013 with our inductee, Gail Russell.
Well, that pretty much said everything I wanted to say. It is really an exciting moment to me to be in this room with so many journalists whose work that I observe and enjoy, both my coworkers and competitors. And this time and era that we're talking about, where we're all under so much duress for what we do, it's great to see this room full of people that just get up and go to work every day and try to get it right. And the guy who led us on that trek at Fox 5 and WAGA before that was my man, Bud. And if I can borrow from Shakespeare, Bud, we're here to praise you, not to bury you. There's so much I can say about this man because I worked in every second of his 19 years as a news director at WAGA. But I'm not going to go on and on and on because Bud will go on and on and on once he gets up here. But I want to tell you that my basic nature is to research a topic, even though it's one I well know. So I sent out an email missive to all my Fox 5 friends to ask some Bud up for me in one word. If you need a couple words, if you could. And this is what I got back. Passionate, competitive, fierce, loyal, competitive, caring, and I'll explain that later. Lucky, and this was in total deference to the fact that he's married one of God's greatest women on this planet, Annette, and his two wonderful children who are here tonight, David and Anna. Old school, always had your back, would fight the suits for you, and as Randy Travis says, a dedicated, determined, and dependable stick of dynamite. And my favorite, an angry, red-faced Irishman. Bud came into the newsroom every day, very simply, with one mantra. Win. We're going to win. We're going to tell better stories. We're going to tell more stories. We're going to break stories that nobody else has. And we're going to do them in a way that nobody else is going to do. And that was what we all lived under every day. It wasn't always easy. He set a very high bar for all of us and asked everyone, no, let me rephrase that, demanded that everyone jump that bar every day. I think one of my favorite moments with Bud, and I use this euphemistically, was 5 o'clock one day in the afternoon, we got beat on a story by WSB, and Bud came out of that room screaming and yelling. The IT office is down below. We're in another floor. I got called up, and they said, he basically called me in and said, fix it. And it was one of those days, as you all know, you're on the mountaintop of journalism one day, and you're on the valley the very next. And this was one of those valley days. And I had an hour and got it all together and somehow pulled something off and got the facts, got everything we needed to get back off, lead the six, and kind of get us back up on the same playing field. And I walked out of there, office set, kind of thumping my chest, you know, yeah, I did good. Took one for the team, brought us back, we're in play now, this is good. Came around the corner. There's that angry-faced, red angry-faced Irishman. And I looked up at him feeling really good about myself, and he said, what do you have for 10? I thought, I barely know what I've been on the air with 6. But I worked till 10 because that's what you did when you worked in Bud McEntee's newsroom. Old school, yes, but I've always said, and they referenced in this, new wave in so many ways, because when so many companies, so many corporations throughout America were cutting back on investigative reporting, Bud not only didn't cut back, refused to accept cutbacks, but made it grow. It made it bigger. And took what at the time with our executive producer Michael Carlin and me, Virginia Ellis, and expanded into an 8-person unit. 3 reporters, Randy Travis joined us, 2 photographers, a producer, an executive producer, and a dedicated editor, and we've stayed that way ever since. And he was doing that in the 90s when nobody was doing that. And he pushed us as hard as he pushed the rest of the newsroom. It was, as I said, never easy in a Bud McEntee newsroom. But the word that I heard from one of the co-workers, Ms. Kisak, who said caring, and she said, Bud cared about the news and he cared about the people. And if I've heard it once, I've heard it 100 times at a retirement when somebody was leaving us, when somebody unfortunately had passed away in the family, that Bud would get up in front of everyone with Channel 5 and tell them that I know that they have a 5 right here implanted on their heart. And that's how he felt. As hard as he pushed us, he loved us just as much. And that's why I love this man, Bud Mack.
Executive producer in St. Louis to tell her I was not coming. I didn't know that this was the woman's first hire ever. And I'll never forget dead silence on the phone. And I had been told by the person who arranged this switch that everything was fine. Everybody at CBS knew, except her. So there I am on the phone, and I'm apologizing, saying it would have been really nice to work in St. Louis, and I'm sorry. And she said, "Bud McEntee, I'm going to tell you something right now. You will never work for CBS News. As a matter of fact, everyone's going to know this, including Mr. Cronkite." Now, I was 26 years old. I'm happy to say, sidebar, that I met Walter Cronkite at the same time I met Judy Woodruff years ago in an RTMDA. Judy was gracious, as always. And so was Mr. Cronkite. He never mentioned a thing about it. I started as the 11 o'clock producer. I wrapped up a fantastic career at WAGA 30 years later. From the very first day, I was surrounded by some of the best journalists and teachers in the country. I am so thankful to the many outstanding journalists, and I use that word with a capital J, who taught me the right, fair, and balanced way to tell stories objectively, without slant or bias. I've always said that WAGA, Channel 5, TV 5, Eyewitness News, 5 News Scene, whatever you call it, we were fair and balanced before fair and balanced was cool. During my 30 years at WAGA, you saw in the terrific video, and I'm so appreciative of that, I lived through a lot of changes. I used to say I was the news director at 3 television stations in one. A strong CBS affiliate, a strong Fox affiliate, and a strong Fox-owned and operated station. At the time, general manager Jack Sander took a crazy leap and promoted me to be news director. And as I say, we were among the elite CBS affiliates. And then, just as I was feeling comfortable, bam, as my daughter would say, we switched from CBS to Fox. We were a bit nervous. Our competitors were dancing down Peachtree. The death of WAGA. We were WAGA. CBS or Fox, it didn't matter. In fact, that switch was probably one of the best things that happened. We grew in ratings, revenue, number of locally produced newscasts. That growth continued when we became a Fox-owned and operated station. One of the people greatly responsible for that growth is with us tonight, my former GM and friend, Gene McHugh. Gene and I have often said we worked with some of the best in what we call a golden time in local television. I'm very proud of what we as a team accomplished, including the creation of Good Day Atlanta, which now is probably, what, All Day Atlanta? Fox 5 News at 10, Fox 5 News Edge at 11. And not just because Dale Russell introduced me. I am particularly proud of WAGA's commitment to investigative reporting. And as Dale alluded, it was suggested when I first became news director that we follow a cost-cutting pattern taken by many local newsrooms, scale back or eliminate investigative reporting. Needless to say, we took a different path. I believe then, as I do now, that investigative reporting, especially at the local level, is critical to the success and growth of journalism. Whether on local broadcasts, websites, or social media. Investigative is the lifeblood of what we do, and true investigative is more relevant than ever before. I thank those who supported what was called by some my crazy decision to not just maintain the I-team, but rather develop and expand our investigative efforts so as to provide true and unique life-changing reporting that affects all of us. To that end, forgive me if I miss somebody. I salute Dale, Michael, Randy Travis and Travis Shields, and Mindy Lorton, and all who were part of the I-team and who are part of the I-team now. And I salute all investigative reporters, including my friend Richard Belcher, and Karyn Greer, from all around the country, for your commitment to digging into issues that affect the lives of so many and by telling stories that truly matter. Remember, news consumers can get the basic news of the day from a variety of sources in 2016. They've already checked their cell phones and Facebook before they turn on the local morning news. But what they can't get is your uniquely produced local investigative stories, stories that set you apart. I am proud of the team that I helped build and the work family that I've been fortunate enough to call friends over the last three decades. Together, we have witnessed so many changes in this news business, but I think the fundamentals of the game are still the same. Now more than ever, in our nation, as journalists, and therefore the historians of our time, it is so important for a free press. As journalists, we have the opportunity, moreover, the obligation to ask meaningful questions of decision makers. And I encourage all to explore the how and the why. How did it happen? And why did it happen? What do we learn from it? What matters is that we produce to the best of our abilities. We commit to great storytelling with unique content. We need to be tough and relentless in our search for truth. People rely upon us to dig deeper and ask the questions they wish they could ask. I guess my stories have been around a little bit, Dale. You're right. When I served as the news director at WAGA, inevitably, somebody would come into my office, interrupt my seventh Diet Coke of the day, told me they were heading off to a new opportunity. And I would always remind them of what a special place WAGA was, and I hope WAGA will be forever. I would tell them as a result of that experience, he or she would forever have that little five carved in their heart. And that goes double for me. I'll always have that little five carved in my heart. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for this great honor.
And now Bud putting his mark on WGCL. We thank you. Where's all the WAGA family? Please stand up really quickly as we move on to the next honoree WAGA. Fox 5. Whatever you prefer to be called. Brenda's in the back there. All right, and our next inductee this evening also worked at WAGA early in her career, but made her mark as one of the most respected journalists at NBC, CNN, and PBS. Let's look at the video screens. Miss Judy Woodruff.
Tonight, Americans decide. Voters head to the polls.
Election night 2016. The results of the roughest presidential campaign in modern U.S. history are unfolding before our eyes. On PBS, managing editor and anchor Judy Woodruff, this veteran journalist, the nation's senior network news main anchor, is reporting it all.
It's taking longer to count some of these days.
For more than 9 hours, nonstop, live, Woodruff guides the viewers and the analysts surrounding her, minute by minute, through surprise after surprise, as the votes come in, state by state.
I thought it wouldn't be this tight, but I mean, can you imagine him getting to 270, the Trump case to 270?
The political experts on the panel reflect the nation's blue and red amazement, but Woodruff, the anchor, the rock, simply calmly reports.
We have another presidential call to make. And
with her powerful command of the facts inside the whirlwinds.
Several states are too close to call.
Is Donald Trump going to
stay? Well, Donald Trump is on his way to...
It is 2:30 in the morning when Woodruff interrupts herself mid-sentence. She has blockbuster news and, without embellishment or fanfare...
Associated Press is calling Wisconsin, so that puts him over the top. Donald Trump is the next president of the United States.
And that's it. It is the purest of reporting. Judy Woodruff at her consistent best. At the top of her craft, getting the facts, letting the facts speak.
To the president-elect of the United States of America, Donald Trump.
So what was it that prepared her for this? There was high school in Augusta, Georgia, then Duke, poli-sci major, class of 68.
And here is the next president of the United States, Donald Trump.
What transformed her into the political journalist that we've always known her to be?
I'm Judy Woodruff. I'm 28 years old, and I'm in the field having regular TV in Atlanta for the past 5 years.
Experience and skill, born of youthful self-confidence and talent and drive. Learning her political beats inside out, developing sources, the rough and tough basics. Woodruff's first big break took her to Georgia State Capitol. She was a couple of years out of college when WAGA-TV in Atlanta hired her to cover the Georgia legislature and Governor Jimmy Carter.
Last night's victory came after months of campaigning.
After 5 years, NBC News called. She was prepared, ready for the challenge.
When Carter first visited Iowa 1 year ago,
she covered Carter's campaign for president. Woodruff had recently applied at all the networks. All turned her down. Until an unexpected opening at NBC's Atlanta Bureau gave her her chance in the field. And her work was spectacular.
Judy Woodruff, NBC News, the White House.
By 1977, after just 2 years, Judy Woodruff was White House correspondent for NBC News. She commanded the beat during Carter's term.
Some Reagan advisors say privately.
And into Reagan's, one of only a few women journalists in what was in Washington then a mostly man's club.
This one.
But it was Woodruff's passion for long-form reporting that would define her career, first at PBS, then at CNN, later, again, and now at PBS.
Good evening, I'm Gwen Ifill.
And I'm Judy Woodruff.
On the NewsHour tonight, Republican candidates.
And in 2013, Judy Woodruff and Gwen Ifill became managing editors and co-anchors of the weeknight PBS NewsHour.
On the NewsHour.
Viewers couldn't help but take note at the time. A full half century after Humbly Brinkley, Woodruff and Ifill were the first female network news co-anchors. Throughout her career, Woodruff has shattered the limits of broadcast journalism, illuminating complex issues and crises and events and politics in the U.S. and abroad. A light in the darkness, always digging for facts. And Judy Woodruff and her husband, journalist Al Hunt, have helped raise tens of millions of dollars for spina bifida research and care. The first of their three children, Jeffrey, was born with spina bifida. They have devoted their lives to supporting fellow spina bifida families. The success of this journalist's career, begun 46 years ago in Atlanta, is measured not just by the big story she has broken, or even by the unqualified trust she has earned, but by the impact she has on the lives of countless others who are grateful for her and her work.
Halls of Fame are often for people who once exhibited greatness, but the thing is with Judy Woodruff, she's still great. And her work ethic, even during this election cycle, has been one that has exhausted even our highest interns at the NewsHour. She's also a mentor, and she's also pulling a lot of us along behind her, both women and men. Sometimes I really do, I pinch myself and say, dear gods, that's Judy Woodruff right next to you.
You're beat, obviously, inside politics. And I guess in some respects, do you think politics now takes a backseat to what has happened in the country? Or do you think, in some respects, they're using maybe the war on terrorism even as a smokescreen to be more political?
Well, that's a very good question.
Seriously? What do you think of her?
I love Judy.
You do?
I think
she's... You've always been that polished.
She has excellent questions. She gives you a little more time than she gives me, I think.
Yeah.
But she's the consummate professional. She's a bright, delightful presence. She's extremely well prepared. And she's a deeply good person. Right?
For one of the few times, I agree with David. And we both, I think, are grateful to Atlanta for sending Judy here to Washington. I mean, she's just where she is, quite frankly, to a Washington institution.
I agree.
You have always been the Hall of Famer for me. Since you started mentoring me at NBC News and we worked together covering Ronald Reagan, I'm out on the campaign trail trying to practice what you have always preached, the kind of reporting that is just a Judy Woodruff report. Your work at CNN and at PBS, the NewsHour, everything that you have done, and just being the greatest friend, the greatest pal on the road and off. Thanks so much, Judy, and congratulations.
I'm Jerry Ratchin, and I've known Judy Woodruff since 1970, when she covered Governor Jimmy Carter for WEGA. Judy's talent and hard work were impressive. So one day, Hamilton Jordan, Jody Powell, and I asked each other, what can we do to help boost Judy's career? The answer was simple.
I, Jimmy Carter, do solemnly swear.
Let's make Jimmy Carter president so Jimmy can go to the White House. With hard work, the three of us accomplished that goal with a little help from Jimmy himself. And so congratulations, Judy, on a truly illustrious career.
Hi, I'm Al Hine, and there's a lot that I can say about Judy Woodruff, but we've been happily married going on 37 years, and I don't want to change that. I will say that there is no place that she would rather be honored than Atlanta. This is the home of her professional beginning, working in local television as a weekend weather lady, which she doesn't talk about a lot, to covering the Georgia legislature, and then going on to NBC, and she loves this city. I remember it was 40 years ago today, when she was a young NBC reporter begging, pleading with the network to send her to Washington to cover the Jimmy Carter administration. They reluctantly agreed, and watching her over these years has been so thrilling, turn from that nervous newcomer into one of the most respected figures in American journalism. She is always fair, and she is unflappable. And it's the same at home in raising three children, but you might strike the unflappable. But she is as accomplished a mother as she is a broadcaster. Her children just adore her, and combining career and family has been so central to her life, and she's done both with such great grace and excellence. So congratulations, Jude. We're so proud of you, and we love you.
A poet wrote, "Truth is beauty. I say, Judy is truth." Never has Judy feared the truth. Always, she's been afraid of missing it. Judy possesses a quiet genius, the ability to listen, learn, explain, write, report, and analyze fairly. Your legacy is truth. Rose petals on your shoulders.
And thanks to all of you for watching. Good night.
The pure, powerful reporter at her consistent best, at the top of her craft. letting the facts speak for a nation never more in need of truth. Judy Woodruff, 2016 inductee, Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
It is my honor and privilege to welcome former First Lady Rosalynn Carter to the podium.
Be here tonight to have the opportunity to introduce one of the most respected and beloved journalists of our time, our next honoree, Judy Woodruff. I have known Judy for a very long time, since 1970, just as you're arriving. When she was a very young reporter in Atlanta covering Jimmy's campaign for governor. I didn't know Judy was around. I knew she was around, but I didn't see her very often because I was off campaigning on my own. Driving from one town to another, passing out brochures, looking for the press, newspapers, not much TV back then, radio stations. I remember turning down a driveway, riding toward an antenna the first day I went campaigning in Florida to see if I could do that in another state. We found the radio station with one person playing music. And I told him that my husband was running for governor and I wanted him to interview me. And he said, what in the world am I going to ask you? And I said, well, I have a list of questions. And when the first day was over, we saw a lot of radio stations. We went looking for antennas after that. Ended up at five stations on occasion, but that's too much about me. I'm going to talk about you. I best remember Judy from those early days when she covered Jimmy's inauguration as governor. A few years back, a TV station in Atlanta, well, it was actually a good while ago, and a TV station had moved out. And when they moved a large piece of furniture, they found a video of Jimmy's inauguration. We were sitting on the platform and there was Judy standing down doing her job. And I thought that day, I thought she is really beautiful and she got this long hair that turns up at the end to sing some of the pictures. Five years later, it was Judy who convinced her bosses at the network that they should pay some attention to this man from Georgia who said he was running for president. And she did the first profile on Jimmy that aired on NBC. Well, as you probably know, or as you do know, Judy's instinct about Jimmy's potential was right on target. And as her reward, she got to live in a motel in America's Georgia for 3 months, covering our transition to Washington. Journalism is such a glamorous business. NBC made Judy chief White House correspondent during her years there. She covered my trip to Latin America soon after Jimmy became president. And you can imagine how good it was to look up at the press, had a cadre of press myself by then, and see Judy's face among that sea of male faces. Judy was one of those hardy reporters who filed stories from the cozy inn in Thurmont, Maryland, during the ups and downs of the long Camp David summit in 1978. She stuck with it through all those 13 days and was at the White House when Prime Minister Reagan and President Sadat signed the peace accord. I'll never forget that day. Mrs. Reagan and I had been at Camp David and we went into town because there was a concert at the White House that we had planned before we knew we were going to be at Camp David for 13 days. We were standing at the top of the steps outside the Blue Room when the elevator with the men coming back from Camp David arrived, landed in a helicopter on the lawn at the White House, South Lawn. And Prime Minister Reagan got to Mrs. Begin before Jimmy got to me, and he said, "Mama, we're gonna go down in history for this." Did you hear that, Judy? I wondered if you heard that. Jim and I take credit for Judy's long and successful marriage. During the 1976 campaign, members of the campaign staff in Plains would play softball against the press corps. Judy met her future husband, Al Hunt, who was a reporter, as you all know, on the softball diamond at Plains High School. Our campaign staff usually won those games, as I recall. But the press players complained because we are those big athletic Secret Service guys on our team. Still, I think Judy and Al were the big winners there. Judy has been a fine journalist for a long time now, and she has covered just about every subject you can imagine. I especially appreciate her reports on mental health and stigma, which I have worked on so long and which is near and dear to my heart. All respect and applaud Judy's excellent work, well read, and you've heard these already tonight. Wagner, NBC, CNN, Frontline, The News Hour, or Generation Next. It's my pleasure to present Judy with this plaque, representing the recognition and the esteem of her peers and of all of us here tonight. Congratulations, Judy, on your induction into the Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
Mrs. Carter, I am so honored that you are here tonight and so appreciative of what you said. You know, the truth is if we had followed Rosalynn Carter during that campaign back in 1970, we would have known a whole lot more about what was going on than following her husband. And she's absolutely right about the motel in Americus. But Mrs. Carter, given the schedule that you and President Carter keep, what is it, 20 countries every 2 weeks? Something like that. I am just especially grateful that you made time to be here. I have to say again, for the extraordinary contributions that Mrs. Carter and President Carter have made, for the work they continue to do from one overlooked part of the world to another, to improve the lives of people who are least able to do for themselves, for the work that you have done, especially in the field of mental health, for the difference that you've made. I want to ask everyone to please give Mrs. Carter a hand. Told my story about the softball diamond. It was where Al and I met. He was with the Wall Street Journal, and they had sent him down to cover then Governor Carter. I was covering him for NBC. And one thing I want to point out is that it was the press corps against what was supposed to be the Carter staff. But you never saw people like Jerry Rapshoon, who's here tonight. Where are you, Jerry? Or Hamilton, the late beloved Hamilton Jordan or Jody Powell. You saw the Secret Service agents. So the press, we never had a chance. And I just want to start out by thanking and honoring tonight's other honorees. Bud McEntee so admirably ran coverage. I love hearing those stories about what you did to lead that great news organization as long as you did. And it, as somebody mentioned, it was where a few years earlier I worked covering Governor Carter. But congratulations on your impressive body of work. Still to come, you'll hear about Gene Patterson. I was so lucky to know that great man for the last 25 or 30 years of his life. And John Smith Sr., editor of the Atlanta Inquirer. You're going to be hearing about him. It was the new kid on the block back when I was in Atlanta, but it was already having an impact and making a difference then, and I know it's gone on to make an enormous difference over the years. It is such a treat for me to be back in this city that is so important to me, to reconnect with so many friends here tonight, to be with people like Xernona Clayton, who's sitting right here, with Pat Mitchell, and so many others. It's just a night that I have loved to be part of. And I'm just incredibly honored to be inducted into this wonderful Press Club Hall of Fame. Such an esteemed group you've already recognized. It includes my former NewsHour colleague, I have to say her name, Charlene Hunter-Gault, whom you honored just last year. I'm honored not only because this is what you get when you've been doing something for so long, they don't know what else to recognize you for, but also because this truly is the city where I cut my teeth as a reporter, where I learned what journalism can and should be. It was here that I learned to watch carefully how Bill Shipp of the Atlanta Constitution, another Hall of Famer, did his job, asking politicians tough but fair questions, where I observed the late beloved Ray Moore, television newsman, mentor to me, insisting that a reporter's work is never done, that you not only have to have two sources for every piece of original reporting, but that journalists play a critical role in the civic life of a city, of a state, and of a nation. And Bob Brennan, another mentor, who hired me for my first job as a reporter at WAGA and kept me humble, reminding me to take nothing at face value and that there's almost no story that can't be written better and shorter. Of course, it is also the city where my first boss, the news director at then WQXI-TV, told me after he'd given me a job as a newsroom secretary right out of college. He said, besides, how could I not hire somebody with legs like yours? And who was succeeded by, you'll notice I'm not naming any of these individuals, who was succeeded by a news director who, whenever I mentioned that I wanted to learn more about reporting, I wanted to follow reporters around to understand how they did their job, he responded, but Judy, we already have a woman reporter. But I eventually did get a break, and I learned so much in my time here, even without the access that I really wanted, Mrs. Carter, in the administration of your husband, Governor Carter. Enough that when, 40 years ago, NBC News asked me to join their White House team covering the incoming Carter administration, I had enough confidence to say yes, but enough humility to know that I still had so much more to learn. And that brings me to one more mentor who is here tonight, the human dynamo and fellow Hall of Famer named Tom Johnson, who's sitting right there. Persuaded me to go to work for CNN, where under his leadership and the leadership of Ted Turner, I was given an incredible opportunity to be part of an international news gathering organization, a place that broadened my horizons and became the place where I learned so much that I never could have learned in the circumstances where I was. And along the way, Tom and I became very dear friends, both he and his wife, and Gwen, and I'm so thrilled that both of you are here tonight. But I'm so thankful over the years for having that front row seat, we like to say the journalists have, a chance to cover the peace talks at Camp David, the aftermath of terrible events like the 9/11 attacks, the financial collapse in 2008, to report on 11 presidential elections over the years, because all of this has given me a window into humanity and a chance to deepen my understanding of the best and the worst of our world. In that spirit, I want to dedicate my participation this evening to my dear friend, colleague, and NewsHour co-anchor, Gwen Ifill, whom, as you know, we lost 2 weeks ago. She's left a big hole in my heart and in the hearts of so many others. I call her a supernova. The tributes to her have poured in from literally everywhere. Gwen and I were the first women co-anchors of a national newscast. We sat beside each other every night, along with political conventions you saw at debates and election nights. I said at her funeral that we didn't look like other anchor teams, and we love that. We grew so close, we joked that we were like an old married couple. At first, we would email each and every night to make sure we weren't going to be wearing the same color on the air the next day. We couldn't be the Bobbsey twins. But at some point, we began to intuit what the other person was thinking. So no more emails titled Wearing Red. We would just show up, and somehow our jackets never clashed. Gwen broke through barriers in her moves from newspapers to television and eventually to PBS. I faced barriers as a woman. Gwen faced higher barriers as a woman and a person of color. She will always be an inspiration to those who question whether there's a place for them in the highest ranks of our craft. That and what Gwen loved about journalism and believed that it could be is her enduring legacy. She, like most of us, went into journalism, as she once said, because she always thought there'd be new and exciting discoveries just around the corner. She gravitated to covering politics because she loved this country and she cared about where it's headed and because she was good at asking those tough questions. But they weren't tough for the sake of being tough. She said in a commencement address at Wake Forest University just 3 years ago that her years spent covering politics had made her skeptical, but not cynical. You see, cynics think they know the answers already, and then they stop listening, she said. Skeptics always have more questions to ask, but we are willing to be persuaded to the honesty of an alternate point of view. We have never needed journalists like Gwen Ifill more than we do today. Reporters who are firm but fair, who hate making mistakes, but admit it when they do. Who hold public officials accountable. Who understand how much is at stake as leaders make decisions that affect the world that we live in today and the world that our children and our grandchildren will inherit. Who live by the creed without fear or favor. Why? Because the way Americans get news has changed so dramatically in a short time. It's coming at us a lot faster, but in smaller bites and tailored to our opinions. Fewer of us are open to hearing another side. Our country is growing more divided, not just by race and income level, but by our political views. We are moving into enclaves where we may never have to encounter someone who sees the world differently from the way we do. At the same time, we journalists are confronting issues that never used to cross our minds, like how to understand the people we cover based on what they tweet, and how to handle information that emerged from an unfriendly foreign government's hacking into our campaign email systems. More than ever, we need young, smart, young people to go into journalism and news organizations that are viable and prepared to support them. More than ever, we need the best and the brightest in the tradition of Gwen Ifill, who was the essence of the kind of journalism we want to practice. And that calls to mind a bond that strikes me here tonight. With Gwen, who was the most prominent African-American journalist in this country. With John Smith Sr., who gave African-Americans a voice when they otherwise didn't have one. And with Gene Patterson, who fought bigotry and bias and was a central part of the city that was too busy to hate. Now, as much as then, we need a sense of reconciliation as champion by these three great journalists. That is a mission for all of us in these days and months ahead. Thank you, Atlanta Press Club, for this wonderful honor. Carter, thank you. CNN, where are you? PBS, stand up. Let's see all the family members, NBC. Everyone who's here, support Judy. Our next induction is credited for helping to give a voice to Atlanta's youth during the fight for civil rights. John Smith, Sr., and the founders of the Atlanta Inquirer.
A celebration of John Smith, Sr. in March 2016 at City Hall in Atlanta. And it begins with prayer, thanking God for Smith.
A man of real intelligence. We thank you for Brother Smith.
Sunlight and memories fill the reception room. Warriors of the civil rights movement with their children and grandchildren thanking John Smith Sr. for rising up with courage the way he did, when he did. Helping tell the world so long ago, when they were all so young, about their brand new Atlanta student movement.
When the students couldn't get their message out to the mainstream media, including African-American publications, the students got together and formed their own newspaper, and John Smith was there at the beginning.
It was in 1960 when students from the campuses of Atlanta University Center, including Morehouse and Clark and Morris Brown and Spelman, began nonviolent demonstrations in downtown Atlanta, risking their lives, challenging Jim Crow laws and customs. They simply sat peacefully at whites-only public lunch counters, wanting to order coffee and food. And they tried to patronize other white-owned businesses, and police arrested them. But few people were aware of any of that. There was little, if any, news coverage. Not even from the Atlanta Daily World, run by Alexis Scott's family.
My great uncle, who was publisher at the time, was more of a contemporary of Daddy King and some of the old guard in Atlanta civil rights. And they did not really appreciate the street movement, the direct confrontation movement. They were more in tune with going through the court system.
So, in August 1960, they start their own newspaper. The founders are leaders of the Atlanta student movement, including Julian Bond and Lonnie King, along with supporters like Herman Russell and Jesse Hill. And they call their new newspaper the Atlanta Inquirer. And within months, they bring on Morehouse grad, Army veteran, and Atlanta Public School math teacher, John B. Smith, to be editor.
Atlanta Inquirer becomes the voice of a movement. It begins to document on a daily basis this little movement that began in Atlanta with a handful of students, most of them 17, 18, 19 years old.
Smith's bold coverage in the Inquirer began to attract international attention for the student sit-ins, and the city of Atlanta ultimately transitioned to public integration without the riots some cities suffered.
And so people had to be convinced, and they were convinced by the accurate reporting and the clear articulation of what their mission and purpose was, and the Atlanta Inquirer was central to that.
But John Smith wasn't finished. He worked to build up what he called the nation's black press in cities across the U.S., helping lead the National Newspaper Publishers Association, all while publishing the Inquirer, now with his son, nonstop since that first issue in 1960, still tackling issues roiling the nation.
Current issues like police brutality, city government issues, everything that impacts the black community is part of the Atlanta Inquirer's table of stories.
So on this late winter day of memories and official thanks from a grateful city, Smith defers to others who speak of him as a quiet warrior. Smartphone cameras raised and recording as Robert Franklin, President Emeritus of Morehouse College, praises Smith and his mighty sword.
Thank you for dipping your pen in acid and writing words that challenge the conscience.
John B. Smith Sr., along with the founders of the Atlanta Inquirer, inductees into the 2016 Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
And please join me in welcoming Atlanta City Councilman Michael Keating.
Thank you and good evening. It is really a pleasure for me to be here today. It is great from the perspective of being an elected official. To be here with so much press and not be the point of interest for that press. That's a joke, you can laugh. But I really do feel privileged to be here tonight to bring to the stage Mr. John B. Smith Sr. I remarked to Michael Russell as we were making our way into the room here this evening, he said he doesn't remember a time not knowing John B. Smith. And I said, you know, I share that same experience. The Inquirer was started before I was born. And he and my father, Lionel Smith, and Carl Holman, and dozens of others that were there at the beginning of the founding of that great paper and institution began it at a time when it was dangerous to do so, when it was unheard of for young people, young entrepreneurs to do so here in the city prior to Atlanta being the city so-called too busy to hate. You know, it was 1960. Atlanta was a segregated place. It was a better southern city than most in the atmosphere of the southeastern United States. There's a famous story that remarks that in 1960, all of the Eisenhower highway system signs, when you're moving your way south, pointed toward Birmingham. Today, they now point towards Atlanta. The efforts of John Smith and the Atlanta Inquirer helped make that tremendous change. And it's not just the direction of where you might drive or use as a reference point where you may drive on the highway. It's a reference point for how to advance our civilization, how to advance our culture, how to advance our relations, and how to secure the freedoms of individuals, whether they be African American, female, LGBT, how to make a difference in a community by pursuing the truth and reporting that same truth. The Atlanta Inquirer began as an outgrowth of the students who were involved in the movement that on a weekly basis used to publish a newsletter. Some of you may be familiar with Connie Curry, who was an early ally to the student movement. And my father and Ben Brown and others drafted her, and they jokingly said it's because she had an old mimeograph machine. And so for those of you who may not be old enough to remember a mimeograph machine, it was a hand-cranked copy machine. And so when the students began their movement, the educational leaders around the Atlanta University Center said to them that they needed to publish their manifesto. They did the Appeal for Human Rights, which was published in Atlanta Daily, was published in the Atlanta Journal of Constitution, New York Times, and so forth. But after that publication was made, on the activities that were ongoing for the students, there were many, because they mobilized over 4,000 students in the Atlanta University Center for different efforts, you know, throughout the city and targeted demonstrations around Atlanta. They needed to get the word out to the silent majority in their community. Now, I don't mean the silent majority in the majority community. I mean the silent majority in the African American community who was not sold on their movement. As was alluded to in the film by Alexis, the old guard, what became known as the old slow progression of negotiation and lawsuits. They didn't believe in direct action. They felt that it was dangerous for activists in Atlanta to engage in that kind of activity. One, because most of the folks in Atlanta who were African American worked for the white establishment in some way, shape, or form, whether it was in individual homes or in businesses. And they felt if they became active in that direct fashion way, they would lose their jobs. They'd have a negative impact. And it would flow back at them in a very negative way. So they were very suspicious of those types of activities. So it became imperative to get the word out and to continue to educate that silent majority in the African American community about the earnest efforts of the students. And out of that outgrowth, them called Holman, Honoree tonight, they established the Atlanta Inquirer. And for more than 56 years, they have pursued the truth, they have reported the truth of authentic Atlanta stories from the African American perspective. And they have not limited their coverage to just the African American community. They've been a crusader for truth on many, many fronts throughout that 56-year history. And John B. Smith, on his own, is a tremendous man and individual. Having known him my entire life, short 50 years, since I was pleased to join the rest of you here in Atlanta, he has been a stalwart in the community, in the West Side community where I grew up, and has always been a mentor, always been a person that had the good advice and could put his hand on my shoulder to give me that kind of fatherly advice, whether it be political or personal. So from a personal sense, I'm really honored to be here tonight to bring him to the stage as you all honor him for this tremendous honor that he is more than deserving of.
Right.
He is a tremendous individual, and as was shown in the film, you know, we honor a lot of people at City Hall. We like to do it. We want to highlight folks who are unsung heroes, who are giving back, you know, to Atlanta who otherwise probably wouldn't be recognized. And so, you know, we have, you know, folks come down to help celebrate some of those honorees. And do you know that John B. Smith Sr. got the largest crowd ever at City Hall in March? Any group of folks that we've ever honored or brought down there to bestow their day. And it was really wholly appropriate. And even though that was a short clip, if you could see the happiness and joy, not only on his face, but on those who came to honor him, because he has touched every facet of the Atlanta community.
Yeah.
This is a tremendous man who, not only as an officer in the national, let me get this right. This is where the 50 years begins to show. It is the National Newspapers Publishers Association, where he's led the effort to bolster African-American newspaper publications around the country. He's been a stalwart advocate for that. He has also done so here by putting pressure on other publications because of the truth that they pursue and the truth that they report. Telling the stories that other folks might be squeamish about, telling the stories that, you know, we don't want to embarrass our friends about, standing up for right regardless of where the story leads or where the information goes, following the facts to bring that light out of Olympus down to the people like a great Prometheus. This is John B. Smith, Sr. Ladies and gentlemen,
It is indeed an honor to be home without me. Thank you. You may not have known some of the stories, the highlights of the story, Mary Carey from 1960. Would you believe a Vogue magazine by the name of New York Times came to Atlanta to interview the Atlanta Inquirer? And this is what they quoted. A loud voice in Atlanta. We thank them for that honor. You would not know that it was the Atlanta Inquirer that broke the story when Hank Aaron's wife was incarcerated for something she would not give the honor. It was on a national level. National newspaper picked up the story about the Payroll Wall. It's an honor with you. Some of you do not know. To seek out the truth and report it where I feel favored.
That's it.
To my colleagues in the Atlanta University system, I thank you for allowing me to go on this journey with you. I'd like to thank my family at this time. My son and my daughter,
right,
who are here with me. And my daughter, who is my oldest child, has a name. Another very, very special person I'd like to thank by the name of Sally J. Warner. You're talking about a friend. That's a real friend. To Herman J. Russell, the late Herman J. Russell. To the late Jesse Hill Jr.
Right.
And others who mentored me and gave me the guidance I need to be part of the person I am today. I thank them as well. And I thank so many of you who I call friends, if not before tonight. Tonight and here before.
Yes.
There's a poem that I learned in the ninth grade. As a boy who never dreamed he would meet one president or two presidents or three. He said, I am on a piece of work. After I leave your hand, you may never see me again. Therefore, put into me your breath, so that I may stand for a man that need not be ashamed. Though I may have hurt some of your feelings, know this, I did it out of truth and love.
Right.
Paula, thank you for the phone call to let me know this day was coming. Thank you, Jane. A true magnificent spirit of the Lord. Lauri, thank you. And Maria, my friends. I love you very much. And I will always be appreciative of this evening and this night. That as I go on this journey, I would know the many angels that joined me along the trail. But I want all of you to always hold this in your heart. Always.
Always.
Be understanding of the young. Compassionate toward those who are less fortunate than we.
You.
if I had but 10,000 words, it would not be fair to you. My gratitude for this evening. But I say to all of you, 10,000 times, thank you, thank you, thank you.
We love you.
John, please stand up. All words for us to take with us tonight. What an amazing evening this has been, and we are not done yet. Before we get to our final induction for the evening, we want to give a special recognition to the team who actually put together these wonderful tribute videos for each one of our inductees. We thank everyone who took the time to actually be interviewed for each video, and we give a special thank you to Richard Crabb with Kettle Creek Media. Richard, are you here? Oh, former photojournalist with me at Channel 11. And Hall of Fame event chair John Sherrick with WXIA-TV for writing and producing these amazing videos. I didn't see John. Oh my goodness. And we also appreciate Jay Watson for providing the narration. Our hats off to all of them this evening. Now our final induction tonight goes to someone who also was a strong voice during the Civil Rights Movement. Our final induction for this evening goes to the late Eugene Patterson.
Somewhere along the way, sometime early during his 41 years in journalism, Eugene Patterson awakened to the power of the centuries that was inside him.
Because you're telling the Southern white that what his daddy and his granddaddy believed was wrong, and that's hard to accept.
The power that would pour out of him, the power of the printed word to transform, so that even here, in this now tranquil park in Birmingham, a half century removed from the hell on earth, a transforming world can embrace Patterson's hope of children at play with doves. Dogs of war once ruled, even here.
Now, 1963 was a year full of violence in the South, racial violence. Birmingham in April and May of 1963. Earl Conner brought the dogs and the hoses out against demonstrators at Kelly Ingram Park in Birmingham.
Journalist and historian Hank Klibanoff, standing at the Northwest Atlanta home where Eugene Patterson and his family lived in 1963, speaks of how Patterson, by then, had already been the editor of the Atlanta Constitution for 3 years, succeeding the giant Ralph McGill. And Patterson followed McGill's practice of writing a column a day, 7 days a week.
So in September of 1963, specifically on a Sunday, September 15th, Gene was out here mowing this lawn. And his wife comes and says, Gene, you've got a call from the office. It sounds pretty urgent.
And that is how Patterson learned. on that Sunday morning, someone detonated a bomb in a church in Birmingham, in Birmingham's 16th Street Baptist Church. The explosion killed four children, four girls. Three of the girls were 14, one was 11. Patterson immediately drove to the Constitution's downtown Atlanta newsroom and went to work.
And he does some reporting, he makes some calls, and he writes what would be his signature column of all time, A Flower for the Graves. And it's the most poignant, moving, powerful piece of his career.
A Negro mother wept in the streets Sunday morning in front of a Baptist church in Birmingham. In her hand, she held a shoe, one shoe from the foot of her dead child. We hold that shoe with her. Every one of us in the white South holds that small shoe. The power of 557 words. Eugene Patterson's elegant and scorching words excoriated the white South for refusing to condemn and combat racial terrorism. He charged and convicted the white South of silent complicity in the murders. We broke those children's bodies, he wrote. If our South is ever to be what we wish it to be, we will plant a flower of nobler resolve for the South now upon these four small graves that we dug.
But it just riveted the nation and moved people to great and deep and profound emotions. It was that church bombing and the reaction to it, led in part by Patterson's column, that moved Congress to approve the 1964 Civil Rights Act.
The power of the printed word. Who was this man? His roots in South Georgia, born in Valdosta, reared in Adel, graduated from the University of Georgia with a journalism degree, served under General Patton in World War II, earning a Bronze Star and Silver Star, reported around the world for United Press, edited the Constitution. Editorialized against the Georgia legislature for refusing to see Julian Bond because of Bond's opposition to the Vietnam War, and the U.S. Supreme Court agreed with Patterson. Patterson earned the Pulitzer Prize for editorial writing in 1967. Then, as managing editor of the Washington Post, Patterson, with Ben Bradley, helped convince Katharine Graham to publish the Pentagon Papers. And Patterson went on to lead the St. Petersburg Times and then the Poynter Institute.
I'm Kevin Riley, the new editor of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution.
I mean, how could anyone look at Gene Patterson's work, especially during his time in Atlanta, and not realize how good it was, how courageous it was? He lifted up all of American journalism with the message that if we can handle reporting and leading in times like this in Atlanta, Georgia, then everyone should have the courage to take on those tough issues in their communities.
And so it was in 1994, at the dawn of the internet age, C-SPAN viewers heard Gene Patterson predict the future as he spoke of the power of the printed word in history.
To break the silence on the segregation laws of the South, the newspapers that stood up and flew a flag of questioning and advising change did have an effect. And we look to a brave new century here that we may wind up delivering the printed word by fax or by on a screen even. But the written word will prevail, but it all rests on the printed word.
The power of the printed word, pouring out of Eugene Patterson's courageous heart, transforming us all. Eugene Patterson, 2016 inductee into the Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
Please join me in welcoming the White's icon, leader, amazing woman here in Atlanta, Ms. Xernona, Clayton. Giving me this high honor tonight, because to be chosen to introduce a man
for whom I had great love and respect, pleases me greatly. And by the way, audience, don't you think Atlanta has the best press corps in the United States? Eugene Patterson, one of the most distinguished journalists of the 20th century. He was a war hero, and he had editorial assignments in many of the country's leading newspapers. The Washington Post, St. Petersburg Times, and jointly at the Atlanta Journal and Constitution. And he worked for the United Press. And he had a stint at Duke as a university professor. His journalistic career has been most impressive. He was a man of great conviction and courage. And he was so proud to have served on the U.S. Civil Rights Commission as well. Now, we know Rodney King coined a slogan, "Can we all get along?" But it was really Eugene Patterson who, through his commitment for equality, established the thought even better. He truly believed that we as blacks and whites could get along in this society. He spoke directly to white Southerners and urged them to accept equality between all races. I had spearheaded a project in Southwest Atlanta encouraging blacks and whites to live together, not have white flight all the time. I called the project SWAP, an acronym for Southwest Atlantans for Progress, where we encouraged the people to swap houses, swap children, swap churches. Well, Mr. Patterson liked that project and encouraged me greatly and supported me extensively. Black ministers spoke at white churches and white ministers spoke at black churches, and the congregations mixed. One day, a white caller called Mr. Patterson and expressed her anger. She said, "Mr. Patterson, these colored people are just taking everything away from us white people. They took our schools, our neighborhoods, and now our churches. Mr. Patterson, you've got to do something. Please write about that." And he did. She probably didn't like what he wrote, but he wrote it. Mr. Patterson was a man of great wisdom, and I loved spending time with him, but what I didn't enjoy so much is when he would call and invite me to go to lunch, he would say, "We're just going to talk about the problems of the world," and as soon as we get to lunch, he would talk about his military days. And I said, "Mr. Patterson, I didn't go to the Army, so I don't know anything about the military. So could we talk about something we could both talk about?" Well, it didn't take us long to find something to talk about. But a story a lot of people don't know is when Dr. King was killed, there were calls coming in from all over the world. Mr. Patterson called me personally. I was over at Mrs. King's house. And he told me he had gotten a call from Mr. Nixon, who had just won the nomination, was not yet president, but had expressed that he wanted to visit Mrs. King. But he knew that Dr. King did not support his candidacy and wanted to know if Mr. Patterson knew anybody where he could help him get in to visit Mrs. King. Well, he called me, and I said, well, I don't know whether she will receive him or not, but I will find out. At the house that night were many visitors, and a lot of the people who heard the discussion said, no, don't let him come. He just wants to, you know, show off at this moment, because everybody knew how Dr. King felt about him. When I got into the privacy of her bedroom, I just said, Mrs. King, let him come. This is no time for politics. If he wants to come, why don't we just kind of set some parameters until we can't use an entourage, but he was welcome to visit. I called Mr. Patterson back and told him we've gotten approval for Mrs. King to receive him. And sure enough, Mr. Nixon followed all the things that I had established, and he came in an unmarked car. I think it was a, I don't want to offend anybody, but it was a Plymouth. And just him and two or three security people. He sat by her bedside and said, Mrs. King, we know what Dr. King felt about our movement, but we know you have four children. And Pat and I are coming out to say that as white Americans, we feel some guilt and some responsibility for what has happened to Dr. King. So I have a check that I'm going to present to you that will cover education for all four of your children when they become of age. Very few people know that story. Well, they didn't use the money, but he brought the check anyway. Mr. Patterson is a man for whom I just admired his tenacity, his conviction, his courage. And he sincerely believed all the time, that's why we had such great moments together, because he believed as I do. And I still believe this, that blacks and whites can learn to live together in peace and harmony. I believe that. I wish he were here now to see we've made some progress. But he also would have to say, we've got to buckle up and do it better. I've met a lot of proud pops and grandpops, but Mr. Patterson gave a new meaning to grandfather. He loved those girls. And he said sometimes he wished they didn't even go to school so he could visit them every day. And they're here tonight. I had the great pleasure of inducting him into a project I'm just so proud of. I set up a project called the International Civil Rights Walk of Fame. We inducted him. We have his shoes where we took the footprints of people who have made a great difference in our society, poured the cement, boarded it in bronze, and made a permanent tribute to people who have helped make this a better world. We will be moving over to the Civil Rights Walk of Fame, I mean the Civil Rights Museum in the spring, and we will now have the opportunity to afford 1.5 million people who will come to this park to visit those footprints. I'm proud to have had Mr. Patterson, one of those honorees. Girls, how proud you must be to have a grandfather who loves you, a grandfather who made you proud as he made all of us feel proud, a man whose character you can emulate. Thank you for being here, and Press Club, thank you for this induction.
Thank you for the opportunity to accept this award on our grandfather's behalf. He would be honored to be among the prestigious and accomplished group being inducted tonight. The members of this Hall of Fame represent ethics and integrity in journalism. Our grandfather, in his storied career, used his words to do good in this world. He uncovered corrupt systems, challenged the status quo, and revealed the truth when it was difficult, even dangerous. This was his job as a Southern journalist in the civil rights era. He was faced daily with what was right and what was wrong. And by choosing what was right, he gave us hope. Beyond all this, Gene Patterson was a loyal and faithful friend, a brave soldier, a beloved father to our mother. We called him Granddaddy. His generosity and unconditional love became the cornerstone of our childhood. If you knew Gene Patterson the way we did, you knew that even his thank you notes were worthy of a Pulitzer Prize. You may have shared a newspaper with him in a sunny Florida room, debated football over cocktails, or joined him in boisterously singing Christmas carols around the piano. If you knew Gene Patterson the way we did, you may have received a typewritten note attached to a clipped newspaper article in the mail, spent an afternoon fishing on Tampa Bay, or gotten an enthusiastic tour of the Patterson family farm in Adel, Georgia. If you knew Gene Patterson the way we did, you knew that his passion for journalism was matched only by the love that he had for his family and his friends. It's been almost 4 years since we lost our grandfather. When you lose someone dear, you think of the words unsaid. We're lucky to have so many of his words left behind to remember him by, to comfort us, to teach us, to guide us and encourage us, to see beyond our ordinary world, our own understanding, beyond our own perception. And thanks to organizations like the Atlanta Press Club, Gene Patterson's words will live on through the next generation of journalists seeking truth and justice. In true editor's form, the words that we most remember him by are short and sweet. He said, "Don't just make a living, make a mark." Thank you.
Tonight's program, I want to make a special announcement regarding the papers of Eugene Patterson. Please welcome Rosemary McGee with the Stuart A. Rose Manuscript Archives and Rare Book Archives, along with the Poynter Institute's Roy Peter Clark. Let's give another round of applause to all of our Hall of Fame inductees and introducers.
Good evening. I serve as the director of the Stuart A. Rose Manuscript Archives and Rare Book Library at Emory University, and I'm honored to be here tonight to make a special announcement. I've been inspired by all the stories that I've heard tonight, and it's our job in the Rose Library to collect those stories and connect them to the lives of all of us. I will be joined by Jay Faust, son-in-law of Eugene Patterson, and Roy Peter Clark, vice president and senior scholar of the Poynter Institute in St. Petersburg, Florida. Thanks to them and to the good graces and generosity of the entire Patterson family, which we've just heard so much about, and the Poynter Institute, and the dedicated efforts of my colleagues at Emory University, Hank Klibanoff and Randy Gew, we're delighted to share with you tonight that the papers of Eugene Patterson are now part of the Rose Library and will very soon be accessible to scholars, journalists, activists, historians, students, and curiosity, people who want to engage in these stories and learn more about these amazing lifetime moments. The Eugene Patterson papers are rich in the history that have shaped our city, region, and nation, contained in nearly 90 boxes covering his influence, which we've heard about as an editor at the Atlanta Constitution, where 50 years ago he was writing the columns that would win the 1967 Pulitzer Prize in editorial writing, the Washington Post, and at the St. Petersburg, now the Tampa Bay Times, where he created a newspaper nationally known for extraordinary writers. Indeed, as chairman of the board, he put the Poynter Institute on the map as the best newspaper training ground in the U.S. The papers we have include the accolades he received for his column, A Flower for the Graves, shown on the card at everyone's place setting, a column that Walter Cronkite insisted Patterson read on the CBS Evening News the day after the 1963 Birmingham church bombing. I could go on. After all, there are 90 boxes that came to us. A hallmark of the Rose Library is preserving, stewarding, and making accessible the papers. So in the very near future, you will be able to come and see for yourselves these amazing columns, correspondence, thank you notes, and photographs. I want to thank Jay Fausch and his daughters, Jean's granddaughters, Laura, Emily, and Molly, for entrusting the great legacy of Eugene Patterson to the Rose Library, and to express much gratitude to Roy Peter Clark at the Poynter Institute. At the Rose Library, these materials rightfully join the finest collection of papers of influential Southern journalists, those who stood up steadfastly, such as we've heard, against racial inequality, including other Atlanta Press Club Hall of Famers, Ralph McGill, Celestine Sibley, Margaret Mitchell, Henry Grady, and Claude Sitton, plus many other distinguished poets, artists, and writers. I now turn to Jay Fausch and to Roy Peter Clark to share with me pride in this moment. Thank you all.
Thank you, Rosemary. On behalf of the Patterson family, I'd just like to say how pleased we are that Gene's body of work is coming home to the great state of Georgia, and more specifically to the city of Atlanta, where he did the editorial writing that won him the Pulitzer Prize. And even maybe more specifically to Emory University and the Rose Library, where it joins the papers of many of Gene's contemporaries, including those of his best friend and ally, Ralph McGill. I'd also like to thank Lauri Strauss and the Atlanta Press Club for this incredible honor, for the opportunity to be here tonight. And I'd like to thank Rosemary, Hank Klibanoff, and Randy Gregg, as well as all the other good folks at Emory for their support and spirited advocacy that helped make this transfer happen. But I'd especially like to thank Roy Peter Clark and David Shedden at the Poynter Institute for the many years of loving care that they gave to forge the Patterson collection into the form that it is today. So thank you. Thank you.
I found out by talking to Gene that from 1960 to 1968, Gene Patterson wrote a signed column for the Atlanta Constitution. He wrote the column every day for more than 8 years. He didn't write two on Thursday and two on Friday so he could have the weekend off. He wrote every single day, more than 3,000 columns, and he kept them in a closet. And I persuaded him to give them to me, and I didn't give them back. And I sat in my room and I read them all, every single one of them. And I just want to refer to one that he wrote on September 13th, 1960. He wrote a column about 500 words or so. He wrote it because a woman had written the newspaper a letter. She had been in a car wreck in Thomaston. Do I have that right? Thomaston, Georgia? And a police lieutenant had stopped to help her. The officer had been most courteous, wrote Mrs. Ann W. Smith, a high school math teacher of Bainbridge, Georgia. The officer had helped her. The officer who helped her, Lieutenant W.D. McDaniel, was 9 years on the force, and he said to Gene, if people are courteous to me, I'm going to be courteous to them. The lieutenant was white. The school teacher was black. Gene Patterson thought it was his job to show Southerners, black and white, at their best when he could. With sympathy for the Southern cause, Gene persuaded his white kinfolk that they must change and that the sky would not fall if they did. And can you imagine a time, I would have been 12 years old in 1960, when a single act of courtesy by a white police officer toward a black woman would be considered newsworthy. As we try to heal the wounds of our time, race, politics, let's not forget to look back upon a past when the culture was even more poisonous. This is why the Poynter Institute has worked so hard for the last 2 years to move the Patterson papers from St. Pete, Florida to Emory University, Atlanta. Let students and teachers, scholars and journalists immerse themselves in the work of a man whose physical and moral courage and whose brilliant writing can still light a lamp for the nation. Thank you very much.
That concludes tonight's ceremony. Thank you again to all of our wonderful sponsors on behalf of the Atlanta Press Club. Thank you for attending this Hall of Fame dinner. Have a great evening. Stay safe. Thank you.
Yeah, I know. We're just a lot of really crowded.